like to say good evening to each one of you. And the Bible says that all things work together for good to those who love the Lord and are called according to His purpose. Don't you believe that?
Amen.
I do too. And we are very, very sorry for the people who planned on attending this camp meeting via the internet and watching the programs, because that may not happen now. But what a lesson there is for that, in that for us, because you see, beloved, we think that we may have tomorrow or another opportunity. Well, we'll go to camp meeting next year. We'll be there in person next year. And we'll watch it this year, but you might not get to watch it this year. Now, we're going to try to find a solution later tonight, but it may or may not work. So we'll just have to do the best we know how, and that's all God can ask us, any of us. But I do personally want to thank each one of you for coming, and I know there's some folks over here. I haven't formally met you all or talked to you. I've met you. I know who you are, but I can't remember your name. From where?
From Kentucky.
From Kentucky, okay.
Long time I wanted to come.
We're glad you're here. That's so sweet. We're so glad you're here. And each one is here. And we have folks from Alabama and California and Ohio and all kinds of places here tonight. But I hope that, above all, that the great God of heaven is here tonight with us and to guide and direct us. The title of our keynote address for these meetings is Give Glory to Him. And for those of you who are speaking after me, since I'm speaking first, don't worry, I don't intend to steal your thunder on all those famous statements. I won't be using any of them tonight, probably, because we're talking about the right arm of his message, of the message. But I want to welcome you to the camp meeting. We are talking about the right arm and the three angels' messages. And we want to pray that we can come here together and we can have a clear vision of the message and the work that will accomplish the last work, the final work in us, and complete the final atonement. I'd like to invite you to open your Bibles to Revelation chapter 4 and verse 11. Revelation chapter 4 and verse 11. And if I go too fast, you slow me down. I'll try to keep this at a reasonable pace. Revelation chapter 4 and verse 11. I'll read verse 10 also. The 24 elders fall down before him as set on the throne, and worship him that liveth forever and ever, and cast their crowns before the throne, saying, Thou art worthy, O Lord, to receive glory and honor and power, for thou hast created all things, and for thy pleasure they are and were created. Beloved, everything that was ever made was made for the pleasure and the glory of God. Creation exists to glorify God. You exist to glorify God. The purpose of your life is to glorify God. The purpose of all that you do is to glorify God. And the purpose of God's church, the church of the living God on earth, is to glorify God. God's glory, beloved, is to be proclaimed. In Psalms 22 and verse 23, if we could look at a few verses quickly. It says, ye that fear the Lord, praise him. Can you say amen?
Amen.
No, I didn't hear you. Can you say amen?
Amen.
Thank you. Ye that fear the Lord, praise him. All ye the seed of Jacob, glorify him and fear him, all ye seed of Israel. He says that we are to glorify him. In Psalms 86 and verse 12, Psalms 86 verse 12, David says, I will praise thee, O Lord my God, with all my heart. I will glorify thy name forevermore. He says, I will glorify thy name forevermore. Matthew chapter 5 and verse 16, the words of Jesus. Matthew 5, 16. Jesus says, let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works and glorify your Father which is in heaven. And we'll talk a little bit more about this part of letting your good work show in just a little bit later. But Jesus says that we are to let our light shine and we are to glorify the God of heaven. 1 Peter 2:12. 1 Peter chapter 2 and verse 12. And I want to tell you, if you haven't read the epistles of Peter for a while, right up here. Bring it up here. If you haven't read the epistles of Peter for a while, you need to. He says, having your conversation honest among the Gentiles. Let me just stop. The old English word conversation really means what in our vernacular? Your lifestyle. Okay, so it's not just simply what we say, but all of our lifestyle. That whereas they speak against you as evildoers, they may by your good works, which they shall behold, glorify God in the day of visitation.
Amen.
Now, not all those people, beloved, I want you to think about this, not all those people that are observing these works are going to be saved. Isn't that right?
Mm-hmm.
There's going to be a lot of people who watch us, and they see the truth, but then they don't follow it, they don't listen. And in the day of visitation, friends, they're going to be a part of glorifying God because they've had the word and they rejected it. And God will be vindicated in his judgment. He will be vindicated. Paul says, please listen carefully, ye are our epistle written in our hearts, known and read of all men, for as much as ye are manifestly declared to be the epistle of Christ, ministered by us, written not in ink, but with the Spirit of the living God, not in tables of stone, but in fleshy tables of the heart. Beloved, we can glorify God by the way we live, and people see it.
Amen.
And we are just like an epistle to those people. We are like a letter written to those people. Now let's turn to the text that we're waiting for, Revelation 14. Revelation chapter 14, because we're talking about giving glory to him. Revelation chapter 14, verses 6 and 7. And I saw another angel fly in the midst of heaven, having the everlasting gospel to preach unto them that dwell on the earth and to every nation, kindred, tongue, and people, saying with a
loud
voice, friends, a loud voice, fear God and give glory to him. For the hour of his judgment is come, and worship him that made heaven and earth and the sea and the fountains of water. We are told, friends, that we are to spread this message far and wide, and it is going to bring glory to God.
Amen.
Turn with me to the Old Testament book of Habakkuk, chapter 2, verse 14. He says, for the earth shall be filled with the knowledge of what?
The glory
of the Lord, as the waters cover the sea. Do you know of anything else that covers the sea besides water? God says that I want my glory to be spread just like the water covers the sea. Now, he didn't say the water covers the earth. Did you see the difference? Because water only covers about 3/4 of the earth. But water covers all the sea, friends. All of it. Doesn't miss anything. This is the message of salvation. And he says that in this message about who he is and what he is like, that we are to give glory to him as we share this message about his character, his goodness, his love, his beneficence. But you know, there's another way that God says that we can bring glory. And that's found in 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verses 19 and 20. The Apostle Paul says, what? Know ye not that your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit, which is in you, which you have of God, and you're not your own? For you're bought with a price, therefore, because you've been bought with a price, glorify God in your what? In your body and in your spirit, which are God's. He says there's a twofold program here. We glorify him in our body, we glorify him in our spirit. And so it is important, this message of salvation. Now, what does this word glory mean? Just give glory to God. But what does that mean? Well, the word glory, or the word that we translate glory in the Greek, is a word, and I think I have this word here. It's doxa or doxa, depending on your Greek teacher. And it says, but we'll use doxa today, tonight. It comes from a word that means to think or opinion. But it means praise, honor, glory, but it has several nuances. This word has several nuances. Now, this is just a little graph that shows you how this word is translated in the New Testament. And you can see the large majority of the times, doxa is simply translated as glory. But it's also translated as glorious, honor, praise, worship, and even dignitaries. Dignitaries. And we'll see that in just a few minutes. But let's just look at some ways it's used. And I think the text will help us, by their context, just within the verse, to see some of the nuances of this word. And the first one I want to look at is Matthew chapter 6 and verse 29. And I'll go ahead back just for a little bit of context and read verse 27, 28 also. But Jesus says, which of you by taking thought can add one cubit unto his stature? And why take ye thought for raiment? Consider the lilies of the field, how they grow. They toil not, neither do they spin. And yet I say unto you that even Solomon, in all of his what?
Glory
was not arrayed like one of these. And here this word glory would be used perhaps as we would use in English the word splendor. Beauty or splendor. In Revelation chapter 15, in verse 8, we have another nuance of this word. Revelation 15, 8, and these all these verses we're looking at here, they all employ the same Greek word, doxa. Okay? Revelation 15 and verse 8. It says, and the temple was filled with the smoke from the what? From the glory of God and from his power, and no man was able to enter into the temple till the seven plagues of the seven angels were fulfilled. And here this word is carrying the connotation of brightness. Of brightness. And it's interesting. We can have really two types or two sources of brightness. And sometimes in some languages it's not as apparent the source as others. For instance, I know that from doing photography, you can have a direct ambient light or you can have a type of reflected light, you see. And I might have a light that comes from a main source. Like we think of the light in this room, maybe it's coming from the lamps or somewhere else, but when we see it in the various places, it's a reflected light. We're not looking at the source itself. There's, you know, a direct source and then there's a reflected. But here, it's very clear that this light comes from a direct source. You know, it's not reflected. It's not coming from somewhere else. Turn with me to Romans. Romans chapter 6 and verse 4. Therefore, we are buried with him by baptism unto death, that like as Christ was raised from the dead by the Father. It doesn't say even that he was raised by the Father. It says, but by the glory of the Father. Even so, we should also walk in newness of life. But here he's using this term glory to represent amazing power or might. His glory is to raise those, friends, who are not simply dead physically, but to raise those who are dead in trespasses and sins. And that's why we are told in the spirit of prophecy that the conversion of the human soul is of no little consequence. It is the greatest miracle performed by divine power. Evangelism, pages 289 and 290. Amen. That raising someone from the death of trespasses and sins, the conversion of the human soul, is the greatest miracle performed by divine power. So glory represents his divine power, his amazing power. In Matthew chapter 6 and verse 2, we have another nuance. And the reason I'm going through these, and I have just a few more, I want you to understand the broadness of this concept that we're looking at tonight. Matthew chapter 6 and verse 2, please. Therefore, when thou doest thine alms, do not sound a trumpet before thee, as the hypocrites do in the synagogues and in the streets, that they may have what? Glory of men. Verily I say unto you that they have their reward. And so here he speaks about those who have the glory or the praise of men. In Luke 14, we have another one. Luke chapter 14, verses 8 through 10. Luke 14, 8 through 10. And keep turning your Bible because I could be wrong. Check me out. Luke 14, 8 through 10. Here Jesus says, he gives us some very practical counsel. He says, when thou art bidden of any man to a wedding, sit not down in the highest room, lest a more honorable man than thou be bidden of him. And he that bade thee and him come and say to thee, give this man place, and thou begin with shame to take the lowest room. But when thou art bidden, go and sit down in the lowest room, that when he that bade thee cometh, he may say unto thee, friend, go up higher, then shalt thou have worship in the presence of them that sit at meat with thee. But this word that we translate in the King James, worship, is doxa. You might have glory. You might have worship. Or in this sense, we might say it's a type of honor, respect. Matthew chapter 4 and verse 8. You know this is the section about the temptations of Jesus. Matthew chapter 4 and verse 8. Again, the devil taketh him up into an exceeding high mountain and showeth him all the kingdoms of the world and all the what?
Glory.
All the glory of them, their greatness, their majesty. Now, we said that there was, if I could just go back here, we said that there was an interesting word translation here, and that is dignities. Do you see that one there, dignities? Let's notice a couple usages here in 2 Peter 2:10. 2 Peter 2:10. But chiefly them that walk after the flesh in the lust of uncleanness and despise government. Presumptuous are they, self-willed. They are not afraid to speak evil of dignitaries. But the Greek is doxa. It means those people who have power and are deserving of respect. And that's the way our God is. He has power. Now, I know that there's a lot of you out there tonight that may not appreciate our president of the United States right now. But I want to tell you, he has a position, and he's a dignitary, and he deserves our honor and respect, even if we don't agree with him, you see. That's what the Bible tells us to do, right? It doesn't tell us to badmouth them. It tells us to respect them, and it tells us to pray for them. And I think they need a lot of prayer, right? So we pray for them. That's what the Bible says. Now, in 3 John verse 2, since we're close there, probably on the same page or just one page back, John says, Beloved, I wish above all things that thou mayest prosper and be in health, even as thy soul prospereth. Yeah, that's an interesting thought. He says, be in health, even as thy soul prospereth. But when we think of the soul, you know, we are good Seventh-day Adventists. We understand. We understand this dichotomy of humanity that is flesh and spirit, and together they make a what?
Soul.
A soul. But he says, I want you to prosper even as your soul, as if there's something different here, right? That God wants us to prosper and to be in health in every aspect of our being. I have a body, right? And I want to take care of that body. But you know what? I have a mind. And that mind has emotional health. It has spiritual health, doesn't it? I mean, there's a lot of facets to the human being when we begin to dissect a person. And understand that God is interested in every facet of your life. And it doesn't matter what it is. He has a concern for it. You know, we've been told that there's nothing too small for God to be concerned about if it concerns us. Isn't that a beautiful thought? If it concerns us, there's nothing too hard. But he tells us to glorify him through our bodies. We read that earlier in 1 Corinthians chapter 6. Now, I'd like to say that God is not difficult, is he? God is not arbitrary, is he? He's not capricious. So many people, when they hear this idea of a health message or health reform, the first thing is, I can't do this, I can't eat that, I have to do this exercise, and oh wow, it sounds like God is a tyrant. You know, if you're used to the common lifestyle of the world, if you're used to eating foods that are addictive, living a lifestyle of sin and pleasure. But in Psalms 84, verse 11, and maybe we should read it. In Psalms 84, verse 11, God makes us a promise, and I believe this promise. Psalms 84 and verse 11. He says, For the Lord God is a sun and shield. The Lord will give grace and glory. No good thing will he withhold from them that walk uprightly. Oh Lord, you mean you don't want me to eat pig meat anymore? You don't want me to drink a Budweiser anymore?
Amen.
It says he'll withhold no good thing from us. And so if there are things that God says to avoid, it's because they're not good things. Isn't that right?
Amen.
I mean, we can believe the Word of God, right?
Amen.
We believe the Word of God. And that's what it says to do. In fact, in 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 31, you know the text. It says, whether you eat or drink or whatsoever you do, you are to do all to the what?
Glory.
There you go. To the glory of God. It doesn't matter if we're eating or drinking or exercising. You know, we as Adventist people, hopefully as conservative Adventist people, as people who are interested in doctrine and this truth about God, we are concerned about health reform. And yet sometimes, and I say sometimes, I'm not casting a blanket statement here, but sometimes our focus on health reform is really diet reform. But health is much more than diet,
amen,
right? We realize that there are really truly eight principles, eight laws of health that help us to have good health. And diet is one. Diet is a very important principle, isn't it? You know, but exercise is important. And I know people who haven't touched a molecule of an animal product for many years, but they may not be even exercising one day, right? It's important that we follow the whole program. You know, the water. Brother Malcolm's got addicted to water lately. He's turned on the water, drinking his water. Bless his heart. He was telling us, for those who weren't here at a worship earlier, that he's drinking at least 10 glasses of water. He went on a water fast for a while, drinking at least 10 glasses of water a day, and he can't get along without his water now, and that's great, because none of us can. We really need that water. In Philippians chapter 3, and verse 19, he's speaking here about some of those who are enemies of the cross. He says, whose end is destruction, whose God is their what?
Belly.
Their belly. And whose glory is in their shame, who mind earthly things. You know, I think it's a shame when a man looks pregnant.
It is.
It is a shame. And we shouldn't be like this, friends. God wants his people to not only be healthy, but he wants us to have a semblance, if possible, of looking healthy. Now, look, I understand we're all from different backgrounds. We have different issues and some things that we just cannot help. I understand that. But where we can, beloved, where we can, we should be able to stand up straight and look down and see our feet. Right? Would that be wrong? I'm going to ask you a question. Which of these people do you think is most likely in this picture to be a Christian? The person on the left or the person on the right? I mean, I think most of us would think more likely the man on the right. He looks healthy. He looks vibrant. The man on the left, he has a shirt on and says, I beat anorexia. You know, he's very large. And, you know, in our thinking, according to the Bible, if we're going to give glory to God by the way we live, we would tend to think that this man on the right, and I'm not judging because, you know, maybe it's the reverse, right? Maybe this man's been converted and he's just starting on his program. I go to a gym in Pineville sometimes for exercise, and we have some large people there. But you know what? They're trying to get smaller. They're working on it, you know? So we can't judge anyone, right? But we do understand what our goal should sort of be like. Well, you know, it's not just, friends, our weight. It's not just our blood pressure, but what about our attitudes and the way we live and the way we operate? Which one of these people do you think is most likely to be a Christian? Person on the left or person on the right? We have a person on the left who looks a little grumpy and probably not too happy, and we see someone on the right, and she's happy, she's full of life. I mean, as Christians, should we be happy? Should we be full of life? Oh, Brother Allen, it's a solemn message. We have a solemn message. Solemn message to give. It is a solemn message, but it's a message that can bring joy too, right?
Amen.
Or what about these two people? Which of these do you think is most likely to be a Christian? The one who looks sort of dirty and slobby on the left, or the guy who's neat and happy on the right? We would probably say the guy on the right is most likely to be the Christian, right? Doesn't mean it is. But what I'm saying, beloved, is that if we're going to give glory to God, if we're going to give praise to God, if we're going to exalt God to other people, then we should look like the kind of people God wants us to look like. And we should be, and we're going to look like Him if we are those kind of people. Right? I'll be honest. I look back at myself about 3 years ago, and I felt like I didn't glorify God very well. I just had gotten too thin. You know, we're so worried sometimes about getting too much weight, but I want to tell you, this is not the Let's Be Skinny for Jesus Club either. Right? You know, you can be too thin, and that's not healthy either. And I just felt like, you know, I wasn't as strong as I needed to be, and I had lost weight. And I needed to put on some weight. And I know no one thinks I did, but I've put on, in the last couple years, I've put on about almost 28 pounds. Okay? I've gotten a lot stronger. I feel like I'm healthier. My endurance is better. My strength is better. And I feel like my health is better too. But I realized I wasn't giving glory to God like I should have. And I wanted to do better. I really wanted to do better. Well, you know, there's other ways that we can express whether we're Christians or not. For instance, which one of these two ladies do you think is most likely to be a Christian?
Being attacked by the dragon.
Yeah, the one being attacked by the dragon. So, you know, Jezebel. Today we use the name Jezebel as someone synonymous with a harlot or someone who is highly painted and decorated and wearing jewelry and, you know, attracting attention to themselves, right?
Right.
Okay. And again, I can't judge anyone's heart because God knows everyone's heart, see? But we have to understand that the way we live, beloved, it's not just for us. We don't live unto ourselves. I'm not here for just me. I'm here to give honor and glory to God. And I want to tell you, friends, your personal salvation, friends, is not the most important thing. It's not at all. It's even seeing that your family and your children saved is not the most important thing. The most important thing is that you give glory to God. And when everything bad, I want to tell you something. You are no better Christian than you are at the worst possible moment.
Mm-hmm.
That's where your Christianity is really measured and checked. I'm going to share with you a statement from the Review and Herald of December 6, 1898. Why do not those who have the Word of God work out its glorious principles? Interesting. Glorious principles. What kind of principles? Principles of glory. Glorious principles. She says, it rests upon us not merely to use the great gift of speech in the service of the Master, but to bring glory to God by a consistent life and a godly conversation or godly lifestyle. The fallen world needs the light of heavenly sanctification demonstrated in a glorified character, and it is our duty before the heavenly universe and a fallen world to reach the perfect unity which this prayer presents. It is our duty to reflect the light of heaven upon a world that is under the scepter of Satan. You see, beloved, as we live and as we share good living with others through health reform, the medical missionary work, it will be as, and I'm not going to use the quote, but it will be as an entering wedge into their hearts. Isn't that right? We know that. Now, I found a statement that I want to share because of one portion of it, and I hope it speaks to your heart like it spoke to my heart. But this is from Signs of the Times, August 16, 1905. She says, love the right because it is right, and analyze your feelings, your impressions, in the light of the Word of God. Misdirected ambition will lead you into sorrow as surely as you yield to it. Cherish an ambition that will bring glory to God because it is sanctified by the Holy Spirit. When you think of that word cherish, cherish, I mean it means to love, to care for, to really be enamored with. And you should be enamored and love the concept that your life should bring glory to God because it is sanctified by the Holy Spirit. She then says, consecrate every power of your being to the accomplishment of a holy work. Make every effort in and through the grace of Christ to reach the high standard set before you. You can be perfect in your sphere, even as God is perfect in his sphere. Has not Christ declared, be ye therefore perfect, even as your Father which is in heaven is perfect? You know, that really does away with this idea that we can't overcome, friends, doesn't it? The words of Jesus there, Matthew 5:48, be ye therefore perfect. We are told also in Review and Herald of June 27, 1907, we are to bring glory to God by doing our best to be perfect men and perfect women. That's right. And I believe that. I'm going to ask you a question. I'm going to ask you a little quiz about a Bible text, see who gets it right. Who knows what Romans chapter 3, verse 23 says? For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. What is the effect, you know, cause and effect? What is the effect of sin? It brings us short of the glory of God. Now, I have another question to ask you. It's a little harder. What is the Bible definition of sin, and what is the text? And what is the text? 1 John 3:4 says sin is the transgression of law. So the transgression of law, disobedience to God's holy law, brings us short to the glory of God. And if that is true, then, friends, obedience through faith should bring us to the glory of God. In Romans chapter 4 and verse 20, speaking of Abraham, he staggered not at the promise of God through unbelief, but was strong in faith, giving glory to God. Because he was strong in faith, he could give glory to God, because his faith led to obedience, beloved. And that's pleasing to God. In verse 2 of this same chapter, he says, "For if Abraham were justified by works, he hath whereof to glory, but not before God." We cannot glory in our own obedience. We can't glory in anything we do, because it's all of God. It's not of us. But friends, he wants to do it, and he will do it in us if we'll let him. And when we do it through his power, then we bring honor and glory to him. Isn't that right, Sister Jan? You agree with it. Of course it is. Of course it is. Now I want to tell you about another way that we can bring glory to God, and this is not the most pleasant way. 1 Peter 4:16. He tells us in the prior verse that we shouldn't suffer because we've been a murderer or a thief or an evildoer or a busybody in other men's matters. Well, isn't that an interesting thought? We shouldn't be busybodies in other people's matters. He says, "Yet, if any or any man, any person suffer as a Christian, let him not be ashamed, but let him glorify God on this behalf." If we are suffering for Christ's sake, for the true gospel's sake. Now, during the reign of the Nazis and Hitler, millions of Jews were exterminated, and they suffered persecution. But you know, it really wasn't for God's sake in the same way that Peter's writing about here. These people were not believers. They were not Christians. They weren't suffering as Christians. They were suffering because someone had a hatred against them. The Jehovah's Witnesses were banned in Russia. And, you know, we might think that they're suffering because they're Christians. But remember, the Jehovah's Witnesses don't even claim to be Christians. They say they're not Christians. They say they're something else. But they don't like to be called Christians or associated with Christendom. They're not suffering because of righteousness. They may be suffering because they're odd, unusual, or they seem not to cooperate with the government, right? But that's not what Peter is talking about here. But he says, when we suffer for true righteousness' sake, we bring glory to God. And Peter understood this because Peter had been foretold through Jesus how he was going to die. In John chapter 21 and verse 19. And notice the part of this verse that maybe you haven't noticed before. John 21, the Gospel of John, and verse 19. Jesus, I'll read verse 18 also. Jesus said, "Verily, verily, I say unto thee, when thou wast young, thou girdest thyself and walkest whither thou wouldest. But when thou shalt be old, thou shalt stretch forth thy hands, and another shall gird thee and carry thee whither thou wouldest not." And what was Jesus now prophesying and telling Peter was going to happen? He was going to die like Jesus died. He was going to be crucified. He knew, Peter knew he was going to die like this. He knew he was going to suffer and die. And notice what it says in verse 19. "This spake he, signifying by what death he," that is Peter, "should" what?
Glorify
"God." Friends, when we suffer for Christ's sake, we bring glory to him. And we can count it an honor, as the apostles did when they were persecuted by the Sanhedrin. They counted it an honor that they were worthy to suffer persecution for Christ's sake, because they could glorify God by doing that. And that's what God wants us to do. Friends, heaven is in business to give glory to God. And we should be training for heaven right now.
Amen.
Revelation chapter 5. in verse 11 and 12. And I beheld and heard the voice of many angels round about the throne, and the beasts and the elders, and the number of them was 10,000 times 10,000 and thousands of thousands, saying with a, what? What is it, Brother Daniel? A loud voice. Saying with a loud voice, what are they going to say with a loud voice? Worthy is the Lamb that was slain to receive power and riches and wisdom and strength and honor and glory and blessings. That's right. Revelation 19:1. And after these things, I heard a great voice of much people in heaven saying, Alleluia, salvation and glory and honor and power unto the Lord our God. Friends, heaven is in the business of giving glory to God, and we want to go there someday. We better get in training.
Amen.
Now, I'm going to say one more thing tonight about this issue, and this is where it probably gets a little difficult for some of us, but I think it has to be said anyhow, because there's something else the book of Revelation says about glory, and we need to know it, and it's in Revelation chapter 18. Verse 1, and after these things I saw another angel come down from heaven, having great power, and the earth was lightened with his glory. And he cried mightily with a strong voice, saying, Babylon the great is fallen, and has become the habitation of devils, and the hold of every foul spirit, and a cage of every unclean, hateful bird, for all nations have drunk of the wine of the wrath of her fornication, and the kings of the earth have committed fornication with her, and the merchants of the earth are waxed rich through the abundance of her delicacies. And I heard another voice from heaven saying, come out of her, my people, that ye be not partakers of her sins, and that ye receive not of her plagues. Now it's interesting. I want to ask you a question. Do you think that this angel is Gabriel? Or maybe Raphael or some other name for an angel? Who is this angel, Andy?
Us.
It's us. That's right. Just like in Revelation 14, those angels are symbolic of the people giving the message. This is symbolic of the people giving the message, friends. And it says here that when we give this message to come out of Babylon, that the earth is going to be lightened with the glory of God.
Amen.
We think, oh, you know, if I say come out, if I preach the second angel's message, I'm going to step on toes and people are going to be mad and it's just going to be a bad thing. But God says it will lighten the earth with the glory. And I believe it because God says it, friends.
Amen.
And we can preach the first angel's message and we can preach the third angel's message. But if we don't preach the second followed with the fourth angel's message, we haven't preached the whole message, beloved.
Amen.
And that's just the fact. Now, let's get a little closer to home. Do we have a work or not then? Do we really believe the second angel's message? Do we believe this fourth angel, this other angel that comes down? Is it part of our work or not? Now I want you to notice something in 1 John chapter 2. 1 John chapter 2. This is one of the more simpler verses in all the Bible. One of the most profound verses in all the Bible, and one of the most difficult verses for some people to really grasp and obey in all the Bible. Let's see what it says. Verse 22. 1 John 2, verse 22. Who is a liar but he that denieth that Jesus is the Christ? He is what? Antichrist that denieth the Father and the Son. And beloved, you cannot be Antichrist and the remnant at the same time.
Right.
Because the remnant is Christian. And you can't be anti-Christian or Antichrist and Christian at the same time.
Amen.
Friends, it cannot be. In Romans 15, it's God's desire for us tonight, and I think for a long time until Jesus comes, and forever actually. Romans 15, verses 5 and 6. Paul says, now the God of patience, and I'm just like to testify now, I'm glad he's been patient with me. I've needed his patience, and I'm glad he's been patient with me. Now the God of patience and consolation grant you to be like-minded one toward another according to Christ Jesus, that ye may with one mind and one mouth glorify God, even the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. Beloved, if we're out teaching different things, we can't glorify God with one mouth and one voice.
Amen.
If we don't have a unity of truth, a unity of doctrine, and doctrine is important,
Amen.
Then we can't glorify God as we are to do, and this is what he commands us to do. Beloved, it is time to finish the work. God wants to use us, and we have talents. God has given us talents to help in finishing this work and in bringing glory to him. In Signs of the Times of August the 18th, 1898, we are told by Sister White, she says, there must be no burying of our talents in the earth to corrode through inaction. A persistent indulgence of self, a refusal to exercise our God-given abilities will ensure our eternal separation from God, the loss of an eternity of bliss. These gifts, and beloved, we've all been given at least one, these gifts are bestowed upon us in accordance with our ability to use them, and the wise improvement of each will prove a blessing to us and will bring glory to God. Friends, when you use the talents that God has given you, you bring glory to God. And that's part of the command of Revelation chapter 14, verse 7, that we call part of the first angel's message that we all say we believe and want to follow. Isn't that right, Sister Arlene? And it says if we use the talents God has given us, we bring honor and glory to God. I believe that, don't you?
Amen.
Why do I believe it? Because inspiration tells me, and that's enough for me. And I believe it. It says, every gift gratefully received is a link in the chain which binds us to heaven. Friends, God is calling each one of us, but I'd like to just take a minute, and I'd like to appeal especially to our young people. All you young people, you pretty young people out there, Matthew and your sister, and each one of you, and I think of Ashley here, and even Elliot. We'll appeal to Elliot tonight. He might not catch it for a couple years, but there'll be a day maybe that his dad's going to say, now, we were at a camp meeting a few years ago, and Brother Allen was saying this, and it's going to apply to you too. Okay? And here's what it says. The work of God is in need of youthful ardor, zeal, and courage. Mental and physical vigor are essential for the advancement of the cause of God. To plan with clear mind and execute with courageous hand demands fresh and uncrippled energies in order that the work may be forwarded in all of its branches. God calls for youthful ardor. And then she says this, a young man and young women are invited to give him the strength of their youth, that through the exercise of their God-given powers, through helpful thought and vigorous action, they may bring glory to God and salvation to man. God calls upon you, young men, to make the most of the powers entrusted to you. Cultivate the habit of doing your best in everything you undertake. God is your master, and you are his employed servants.
Amen.
Amen? I think it applies to the lady folks, too. I really do. Now, beloved, let me just make something very clear. Our mission is to glorify God. It's not to glorify ourselves. It's not to exalt ourselves. And I think of a text the Apostle Paul wrote in Galatians chapter 6 and verse 14. Paul says here, but God forbid that I should glory, save in the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ, by whom the world is crucified unto me, and I unto the world. You know what we can glorify in, friends? We can glorify in the cross of Jesus Christ. In the book Acts of the Apostles, and I don't have the reference with me, but I can paraphrase it, I think, close enough. She says, kneeling at the foot of the cross, the sinner has attained the highest place that he can reach.
Amen.
Kneeling at the foot of the cross. You know, we're so concerned that we got to go to Southern University and get a degree, Andrews University, we got to get an MA, PhD, or something like that. But friends, we need to go to the foot of the cross university.
Amen.
That's where
Amen.
We need to be at. We are told in the gift of his son as a substitute and surety for fallen man is an everlasting testimony to the world, to the heavenly universe, and to unfallen worlds of the sacred regard which God has for the honor of his law and the eternal stability of his own moral government. It is also an expression of his love and mercy for the fallen human race in the plan of redemption This Savior was to bring glory to God by making manifest his love for the world. Jesus, he had a purpose and a plan. His purpose and his plan was to bring honor and glory to God. And that, beloved, should be our same purpose and our same plan, to bring honor and glory to him. And I'd like to add also to his son. Turn back with me to the book of Philippians, the second chapter. Actually, in this case, it's forward from where we're at in Galatians. But I say back in the sense that we've been there before. And I'm going to start in verse 1 because I just think the flow is so beautiful. We'll be focusing on a later verse, but we're going to start in verse 1. If there be therefore any consolation in Christ, if any comfort of love, if any fellowship of the Spirit, if any bowels and mercy, fulfill ye my joy, that ye be like-minded, having the same love, being in one accord of one mind. Let nothing be done through strife or vainglory, but in lowliness of mind let each esteem other better than themselves. Look not every man on his own things, but every man also on the things of who?
Others.
Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus. There was a mind that was in Christ, and we're to have that same mind. Verse 6, who being in the form of God, or as one translation says, in the very nature of God, thought it not robbery to be equal with God, but made himself of no reputation, and took upon him the form of a servant, and was made in the likeness of men. And being found in fashion as man, he humbled himself, and became obedient unto death, even the death of the cross. Wherefore God also hath highly exalted him, and given him a name which is above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow of things in heaven and things in earth and things under the earth, and why? And that every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Friends, there's all kinds of ideas about who Jesus Christ is out there, right? And you know, I find it interesting that the one common thread I find in virtually every false religion is the teaching that Jesus Christ is really not the Son of God. Think about it. Within professed Christians, you have the people who believe in the Trinity, and when you ask them, is Jesus really the Son of the God, the only begotten Son of God? Well, he's not really the Son of God. He's just called a Son, right? And then you have your offshoot groups like Jehovah's Witnesses who say he's a created being. And then you have, you know, the Buddhists, and they might say, well, you know, Jesus was an enlightened teacher, but he was just a man. You have the Muslims that say he was a great prophet, but he was just a man. He wasn't the Son of God by any means. And so, you know, all these different groups, and of course, as well as the atheists, the thread that binds them all together is that they don't believe Jesus is the Son of God. But we are to confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father. And we can do that in a way no one else can do it. And there are people out there who need to hear this message tonight. There are people out of the church and people in the church. And they need to hear this message desperately because they don't have the Lord. You know, they have this idea in their mind. They worship an idea. Or they have this very narrow, constricted concept of what Jesus is like. And it's not just the doctrines they need. They need Jesus. They need Jesus. People need Jesus. I need Jesus. You need Jesus.
TP.
Amen.